Hey guys, welcome to another video from Foolish Engineer. Last time, we saw the basics, different modes and how data travels in the SPI communication. This time, we'll see the advantages and disadvantages with answers to why. This is going to be an interesting video. So, let's go for a ride. Initially, we'll see the advantages of SPI communication. It has very low power consumption compared to an I2C communication protocol because there are no need of pull-up resistors and SPI uses clock gating. We know that the I2C communication requires pull-up resistors to create the 3.3 volt or 5 volt idle state. If a device needs to talk, it will pull the SDL line or clock line to low and high continuously to send the data. The value of these pull-up resistors is in kilo-ohms. But as we increase the data transmission speed, this value decreases. For example, we need 2 kilo-ohm resistance for 400 kbps speed, and this resistance value decreases further for higher speeds. So depending on this pull-up resistor value, the circuit draws very much current, which eventually result in power loss. But the SPI communication, it's much simpler because there are no pull-ups needed. The only power requirement is it consumes dynamic power from switching internal transistors and input-output lines. SPI uses clock gating. You know, in synchronous communication, we use clock signals. And these are the great source of power dissipation because of its high frequency and load. While clock signals do not perform any computation and they are used for mere synchronization. So these signals are not carrying any information. The gated clock is one of the most important techniques which can be used in the SPI communication protocol to reduce the power dissipation. If a device is not in use, then the clock line, which includes synchronous storage elements such as flip-flops and latches, can be shut down by turning off the clock of the particular device, which eventually saves power. In SPI communication, we can enable a communication device with chip select, which puts other devices to remain in sleep mode or power saving mode. Whereas in I2C, even though the data packet is not intended for all slaves, all of them need to be awake and allow clock signals to pass. Each slave in I2C communication continuously validates if a data packet is for me by comparing the addresses transmitted on the bus. This phenomenon consumes power dynamically. Let's see a simple analogy. All Avengers are staying in Avengers Mansion. Let's assume every one of them is waiting for mission order from Director Fury. Soon, a confidential mission order comes, which is only for Iron Man. And Jarvis receives that email. Now every Avenger in the mansion except Iron Man comes and asks Jarvis if it is for them. Well, it's not for them, so Jarvis refuses. But finally, Iron Man asks Jarvis about the mission order, and Jarvis simply gives him the mission details and Iron Man goes for the mission. If you check here, this process consumes the energy of each and everyone who is present in the Avengers Mansion. And that's what happens in the I2C communication while the transmission of data packet. Whereas Jarvis would have just called Iron Man and handed him over his mission orders. This process saves energy and time of everyone as well. Now let's consider Jarvis as master. and Avengers as slaves. Well, not particularly, but you can just imagine. And the action of calling the Iron Man is analogous to Chip's recline, which is used in the SPI communication. So, using this, SPI communication reduces power dissipation with remarkable numbers. Second advantage of this SPI communication is it is faster than I2C. In I2C communication, if you want to send any data, we need to send one start bit, one stop bit, acknowledgement bits, read-write bits, and slave address. This increases the data overhead. But in SPI communication, there is no need for acknowledgement. If there is a problem in the slave device, it will notify the master by transferring the data over MISO line. There is no need for slave address either, because the chip select line is there to select a slave. And there is no need for arbitration policy, because SPI doesn't support multi-master configuration. SPI is a full duplex communication protocol. There are two separate lines for communication between slave and master, and this way the communication is faster. If you see the I2C communication protocol bitframe, the master sends the addresses and data initially, and after that the slave sends the data from his side, because there is only one data line, and this mode is called as half duplex communication. Let's see a simple analogy here as well. Imagine the half duplex communication as a string phone device, where just one string carries the sound of both people standing at each end. Imagine the first guy is Thor and other guy is Hulk. If Thor is talking over a string phone, then Hulk has to listen.
We're the same, you and I. We're just a couple of hot-headed fools.
Yeah, same. Hulk like fire, Thor like water.
We cannot talk over the same time. If both talk at the same time, then the line may get disturbed and nobody will understand anything. So, this type of communication is very slow. But if you consider a normal text SMS sent from a modern mobile phone, both people can read and write at the same time without any problem. And that's how a full duplex communication mode works. The SPI has MISO and MOSI lines for the communication between slave and master. SPI is very easy to interface. SPI doesn't support multi-master configuration, which greatly simplifies the data transmission, which reduces the software and hardware complexity. And adding handshaking signals becomes very easy. Some of the SPI devices make use of handshaking signals, like data-ready interrupts sent from a slave device to notify the master about the data is ready to read. There are four modes of data transmission. We have seen these modes in the last video, and these modes give liberty to a device manufacturer to select any of the triggering logics for flip-flops. Whereas in other communication protocols like I2C, we have to keep common standard triggering logic. Well, those were the advantages of the SPI communication. There are some disadvantages as well. First, there are at least 4 connection lines required for the communication, which are MISO, MOSI, clock, and chip select line. And if there are multiple slaves, these connections increase. Whereas I2C or CAN communication need only 2 wires, irrespective of the number of slaves. SPI doesn't support multi-master configuration. When we want to interface multiple slaves, we need more chip select lines, which consume more GPIO pins of the master device. Well, to overcome this, We can use a multi-slave MUX device that makes use of an address-based multiplexer, which selects one output of multiple slaves and enables a chip select line connected to that slave. So that's all about the SPI communication protocol. We have covered basics, different modes, data transmission and reception, advantages and disadvantages of the SPI communication.
I hope you got something from this. If you haven't, you can watch the video again. Still, if you don't, you can ask your doubts in the comment box below. Hit the like button if you like this video, subscribe to my channel, and finally, thanks for watching!